Hello and welcome to our listeners around the world. You're listening to the JAMA Author Interview Podcast. I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, JAMA Deputy Editor. Today we're discussing Staph aureus bacteremia, including an article titled Dalbavancin for Treatment of Staphylococcus aureus Bacteremia, the DOTS Randomized Clinical Trial by Dr. Turner and colleagues, which was published on August 13, 2025 in JAMA. I'm joined today by the trial's senior author, Dr. Thomas Holland, who is an infectious disease specialist and a professor of medicine at the Duke University School of Medicine. Welcome, Tom.
Glad to be here. Thanks.
I'd like to start our conversation by talking about Staph aureus bacteremia more generally. For our listeners, I'll note that Dr. Holland and his colleagues published an outstanding clinical review on Staph aureus bacteremia in JAMA earlier this year, and we'll link that article in the show notes. Tom, as an infectious disease physician, when I'm called about Staph aureus bacteremia, my ears perk up and my heart rate rises, and I'm sure you have the same experience. What makes this infection unique and often quite challenging in terms of management?
Well, you're exactly right about that. Staph is a unique pathogen in its ability to infect a whole bunch of different anatomic sites, to infect almost any kind of prosthetic material that's implanted, whether it's prosthetic joints or intravascular catheters. And then it's also often complicated by antibiotic resistance, so it's often difficult to treat. You know, I think even though we've gotten better over time at managing these infections, it's still the case that 90-day mortality is more than 25% in patients who develop Staph aureus bacteremia. So it scares all of us when we're taking care of these infections.
There are not too many conditions in medicine that have that kind of mortality, so I think that's just a really helpful metric for listeners. This is a perfect segue to the DOTS trial, Dalbavancin as an option for treatment of Staphylococcus aureus bacteremia, which compared dalbavancin with standard intravenous therapy for completion of therapy of complicated Staph aureus bacteremia. And in fact, the trial was designed to determine whether dalbavancin was superior or better to standard therapy. This was an open-label, multi-center trial in the U.S. and Canada that enrolled hospitalized adult patients after blood culture clearance. Patients were randomly assigned to receive either two doses of dalbavancin or 4 to 8 weeks total of standard therapy. The primary outcome was superiority by desirability of outcome ranking at day 70, and we'll talk about that outcome in just a minute. Secondary outcomes included clinical efficacy at day 70 using a pre-specified non-inferiority margin of 20% and safety. I'll add that although the trial was open label, clinical outcomes were assessed by a review committee masked to treatment allocation. So before we delve into the details of the trial design and the results, I want to ask you why you and your colleagues decided to do this trial.
Yeah, great question. Precisely because outcomes are so poor and challenging with Staph aureus bacteremia, first and foremost, we need better treatments that are safe. And because Staph aureus has the tendency to persist and to relapse after the completion of treatment, our conventional approach for these infections is a fairly long course of intravenous antibiotics, the 2 weeks at a minimum, but more commonly 4 or 6 or even 8 weeks of intravenous therapy to try to eradicate these infections. And in fact, most patients are clinically well or at least clinically stable long before they finish these prolonged courses. So most patients are leaving the hospital with a PICC line or a central line in their arm that they can continue to give intravenous antibiotics either at home or sometimes have to go to a nursing facility to receive those. So it's really appealing if we could have a safe and effective alternative to that, first and foremost. I think a second reason that we wanted to do this trial is that through the Antibacterial Resistance Leadership Group, or the ARLG, which is an NIH-sponsored group that tackles antimicrobial resistance, we had the right site network and the right enthusiastic investigators to take on this trial. We felt like it was one we should do. And then I think a third reason is that the antibiotic dalbavancin is promising but untested for this indication. It has data on efficacy and safety in skin infections, but that's not really the area of greatest need. I think clinicians are most interested in using this antibiotic for these deep-seated, often Staph aureus infections. And actually, this data has been published in JAMA Network Open that looked at current use of the long-acting lipoglycopeptide, so dalbavancin and a related antibiotic called aretivancin, and showed that clinicians are using these for deep-seated infections, usually with Staph aureus. So there's interest in using these antibiotics, but we don't have high-quality data to inform that use.
So let's talk a bit about the outcome measures. The primary outcome for the DOTS trial was the desirability of outcome ranking, or DOR, at day 70, which involved five components: clinical success, infectious complications, safety complications, mortality, and health-related quality of life. And this was assessed for superiority of dalbavancin. Not all listeners are familiar with the DOOR approach, which is something you and your colleagues have pioneered in many ways. Can you explain a bit of the background and rationale for using DOOR?
Yeah, definitely. So DOOR is a composite outcome that includes those components that you mentioned, and it's an ordinal outcome, meaning it's a rank-based outcome. You're establishing what do you think is the best and what do you think is the worst and the important gradations in between, and then comparing whether one treatment or the other has a better overall likelihood of a good outcome on that scale. Now, to develop the specific DOOR outcome that we used in this trial, we did a lot of preparatory work before we started this trial. We did work with clinicians who treat Staph aureus bacteremia, making them through scenarios or through surveys weigh the trade-offs between different safety and efficacy outcomes. And then we did the same thing with patients who had survived Staph aureus bacteremia to ask them about their experience and what was important and what were the long-term effects and things like that. And then we used that to derive an outcome that we thought best would match those priorities. And fundamentally, what we're trying to do ultimately is answer the question that clinicians are asking with their patients at the bedside, which is, what's the best treatment for my patient? We don't look at siloed outcomes when we're making those decisions. You have to say, do I think this treatment is going to be effective? Do I think it's going to be safe? Do I think this is going to be by a patient-preferred route of administration? All of those things have to go in together into a single treatment decision. And that's what we were trying to answer in this trial.
So in addition to the primary outcome, there were some really important secondary outcomes in DOUTS. Clinical efficacy at day 70 with a pre-specified non-inferiority margin of 20%, as well as safety. And dalbavancin met the non-inferiority threshold and also had similar safety outcomes to standard therapy.
Yeah, that's exactly right. It's important for any composite outcome that you look at each of the components that go into that. And so we looked at clinical efficacy as a standalone secondary endpoint, like you said. It was 73% in the dalbavancin group and 72% in the standard of care group, so similar there. And safety events, you know, patients with Staph aureus bacteremia, they're sick patients. They have a lot of things happen. And so adverse events overall were common. Those that were related to treatment were uncommon in both groups, and those safety events were balanced.
So Tom, we can sit and dissect these results and pore over the supplemental materials, but for our listeners who are busy clinicians, what should they take away from the DOTS trial? And specifically, how should these results inform clinical practice?
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, what we showed was that dalbavancin was not superior as we measured it to standard of care, but it was as safe and as effective as conventional prolonged IV antibiotic treatments for Staph aureus bacteremia. So I think the take home is that this is a viable option. This is something that we should be thinking about and looking at and prescribing for our patients.
I just rounded a few weeks ago, and I'm finding myself, and again, I had a little sneak peek at these results working with you on getting the paper in shape, but I'm starting to think about this much more. So, you know, these data are really helpful, even if they're imperfect, as all trials are. These are really helpful for practicing clinician.
I appreciate you saying that. We're using it more and more as well. I think that this will help put the clinical community's mind at ease, I hope, that this is a safe and effective thing to do. It's something that we're doing already. We worry about resistance, right? I think it's an important thing to keep in mind that this antibiotic, like any antibiotic, is not a substitute for source control. It's important to realize who was not included in the DOTS trial. That's patients who had retained infected prosthetic material where source control has not been achieved. So this is not going to be a panacea for all of these difficult-to-treat situations. But for patients that have had their source control procedures, have stabilized, have cleared their bacteremia, this is an effective way and a safe way to complete a prolonged treatment course.
Is there anything else you'd wanted to add?
There are some things that surprised us in the results, and I think it's worth noting that we really thought that patients would report a better quality of life, or to be more specific, a delta QOL, a difference in quality of life from randomization to the day 70 mark, if they were randomized to the dalbavancin arm. We thought they would like it better, that they would end up with a better quality of life. We did not see that reflected in the data. And we're actually the third big trial that's had that same finding, both the POET trial of oral antibiotics for left-sided endocarditis and the OVIVA, the oral versus IV therapy for bone and joint infections, also didn't find a difference in quality of life. And so I don't know if it's because we're measuring it wrong and we're just not capturing important differences, or if patients are more agnostic or, you know, as not as moved by the route of administration as we expect them to be. But that was one thing that did surprise me in these results.
Yeah, if I put on my geriatrician hat, I will say that I think patients are really not well with this condition. And when they leave the hospital, they continue to have diminished functional status. They have difficulty getting back to their day-to-day life. And so in some ways, maybe the things we're trying to capture don't really capture the nuance, but I'm sure for families, for caregivers, for patients, not having to go home with an IV line and all that entails is a good thing.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. We enrolled a really diverse set of types of Staph aureus bacteremia or anatomic sites of infection and patient populations. There were patients who were immune suppressed. I think it's really important that there were a significant number of persons who inject drugs, a population that can be difficult to treat and retain in care and for whom the strategy might be really attractive to clinicians. So I think that's another thing that's worth noting about this trial. It does generalize across a wide swath of patients with Staph aureus bacteremia.
Well, congratulations on publishing this wonderful trial, and thanks for joining us.
You bet. Thanks so much.
I'm Dr. Preeti Malani, and I've been speaking with Dr. Tom Holland about the treatment of Staph aureus bacteremia and the DOTS trial. You can find a link to both the review article and the DOTS trial in this episode's description. This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens and Patrick Lyle at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks for listening.
This content is protected by copyright by the American Medical Association with all rights reserved, including those for text and data mining, AI training, and similar technologies.